Hello, everyone, and welcome to another Jakarta Tech Talk. Joining us today, we have Rudy DeBuscher to discuss JDK 17 and what is in it for the Jakarta EE developer. Rudy loves to create web applications with Jakarta EE platform and micro-profile implementations, and is currently working for Payara Services Limited as a product manager. He helps customers, prospects, writes technical content, and is part of some micro-profile implementations and advocates for Payara products in various ways. If you have any questions for Rudy as we move through today's presentation, feel free to ask it in the chat or using the Ask a Questions tab at the bottom. Without any further delay, Rudy, over to you.
Yeah, thank you for the introduction. And indeed, I'll talk a bit more today about JDK 17 that was released last month, and if and how you can use it within a Jakarta runtime like Payara Micro, for example. So a quick look at the topics, what I will cover today. First of all, I'll go briefly over the main language changes between JDK 11 and 17. You probably, most of you have already heard about them or even used them. But a quick recap, what I find important, that what we find important for the enterprise developer. And then I'll show you a demo where I showed that switch expressions, text blocks and records within a Jakarta EE application. Besides those language changes, there are also several operational changes, like garbage collection, etc., which are also important and can be a consideration to switch from 11 to 17. So we go also over them. And then if we have time, my favorite topic, the security related things. So a few words about the changes there. So yeah, JDK 17, that's the next LTS version and the long-term supported version. So that means it's not replaced in 6 months, but most vendors will support it for something like 7 years, where they regularly update the runtime, of course, for security issues, for some bug fixes. But the idea is that the functionality stays the same in that LTS version as of now, and that you have and that you can use the LTS version for all those years without a need to change anything within your code or within your environment. Previous LTS was JDK 11, and before that we had JDK 8 as LTS. So as mentioned, there are several changes, many changes on different levels, and not only the Java language has changed, but also some JVM changes and some operational aspects. So I cover them all, at least which are important for a Jakarta EE developer or a Jakarta EE environment. Quick overview of what the versions of Jakarta EE are and what they support. Version 8 is with that older Java X namespace from the Oracle, and that you can use for JDK 8. At least there are certifications for implementations for JDK 8. Then we have the 9.0, which has the Jakarta namespace, where you have also possibility for certification for JDK 8. And then the 9.1, also Jakarta namespace, but for JDK 11. No mention of JDK 17, which is no surprise, because at the time that, for instance, 9.1 came out, there JDK 17 was not available. So it's obvious that there is no mentioning or even certification possible. For EE10, you will have the option to run it either on JDK 11 or 17. So it is the case that also Jakarta EE is following up closely now with the new LTS versions. But as you will see, it is not that, for instance, the Jakarta EE8 is created for the Java X namespace and with certification for JDK 8, that you cannot use it on JDK 17, as you will see in the demo. So you know the answer already. Does it work? Yes, because I mentioned that I will show a demo. So the Duke can dream about having a sailing on this yacht with the Jakarta EE boat. So it definitely works. There is only a few things that you need to watch out for, and it's a few tricks, let's call it a few tricks that you need to use. But in general, you can already use it today with JDK 17. What are our plans for supporting JDK 17? The version that we release next week, that's the 5.20.21.8, that will already, at least by our micro, will already run on JDK 8, 11, and 17. There are a few, still a few missing elements. There are a few things that are not working entirely on 17, like, for instance, Eclipse Link. So for the database access with JPA. But as you will see, I'm using the release candidate for that release of next week today. So it is working, and you can try and play already with it and give maybe our feedback to us. But of course, the next step is that we have full support for JDK 17 on our products, Payara Micro and Payara Server, which is coming hopefully the next month when we release again. Is the switch to JDK 17 difficult? Because we all remember that when we changed from JDK 8 to 11, that was a big hurdle to take. There were many changes with that modularity of the JVM itself, and there were many changes required at several levels. But this time, the language features at those records, there are a new thing, but except for that you can use it or don't use it, all the language features, of course, still work. That the older language features of JDK 11 still works on JDK 17, that's no problem. There are a few changes in garbage collectors. For instance, there is one garbage collector removed. There are a few new ones, so you might need to change your garbage collector that you are using in JDK 17, but again, that's not a big hurdle. And then, of course, you have changes in a few tools, like the class data sharing option, which I show you later, where you have other parameters now. And so again, if you are using that, then there is a small change required. But again, it's not a big thing to change from 11 to 17. That should be quite easy, and especially not that big issue as we have seen with the jump between JDK 8 and 11. So a quick overview of what I find important in the change from JDK 11 to 17. First of all, those language features. We have now the switch expressions. So a switch can return a value, so it's not only for statements. There are a few streams methods added, which are very useful. Those text blocks for multi-line strings, that was one of the things what was highly discussed the past couple of years. And also those records for creating data transfer objects, which is now much easier. You also have pattern matching, which I'll show you an example. Those sealed classes where you can define the dependencies and the hierarchy between classes more strictly than just with protected and final. One thing that you need to watch out for, that is that some JDK internals are again more encapsulated, so you can see some errors that some classes or packages are no longer exposed to the unnamed module. So you might need to add some at open statements to your project so that they are found. And another nice thing is that we have those Unix domain channel sockets now, which is used, for instance, with the Docker clients. We have them now also within the JDK. From the operation aspect, I mentioned already garbage collection and those Z garbage collector and the Shenandoah, which should provide you a garbage collection with as minimal latency, so that it takes that as minimal time as possible. we have those Dynamics CDS archive now. We have the flight recorder, which is not only for diagnostic purposes, but also for monitoring purposes. We have that support for those risk processors with the new architecture, which is supported. And we have, again, a package tool, which was removed because the JFX was removed from the bundle, from the JVM bundle. But now we have another packaging tool. So if you're creating clients, client packages, that can be done, again, easily with that new package tool. So let's quickly go over the most important new language features. For instance, that switch expression. So as mentioned, a switch returns now a value. And you can use that arrow to indicate what value is returned for a certain case, which makes, of course, it easier in this setup that you don't need to assign a certain variable within the block statement of each case, and that you might forget that break there, so that you have a fall through. Now you can just return it and assign it to a variable. There is still the possibility to use to return a value also when you're using that old style with the colon. First idea was to use break, which is still available, but using break for returning a value can be, of course, very confusing and gives you errors. For example, the line that I specified there with break blue or yellow, that will fail, of course, because that blue or yellow will be recognized as a label. So that means that it tries to jump to that label and break out of the current statement, which is, of course, not possible and not working correctly. So you can use yield there. Yield is a new keyword that can be used then to return a certain value. But again, I'll prefer just that arrow, because then there is no confusion possible, and then it works perfectly, of course. If you are using some block statements, so multiple statements within a case, which is also possible, then of course you need to return a value, and there you have no other option than using that yield keyword, where you return the value to the variable that the switch expression is assigned to. I'm still a bit confused always when I see yield, because when I see yield, I always think about those the method in the thread class. But again, there are some different things, they are not related. A few new messages, sorry, new methods on streams. You might have encountered the requirement before that you have an entire stream with filterings and mappings and whatever you need to do, but then at the end you need to apply a collector, but you should have using two collectors. So you want to use the entire stream with one collector, and then again the same stream with the same mapping and filtering on another collector. That's now possible with that teeing method, where you can specify two collectors and then a function that combines then the two results of the collector in some way. Probably you need to create a custom class that can hold those two values, or I have seen examples where they are using a hash map where there are two elements one element for each collector. That might be sometimes useful. That also depends, of course, on your specific application and use cases. This is a more interesting addition, if you ask me. That's the multi-map. Before, with filter, you could filter out a certain element from the stream. But now with multi-map, you can filter it out, keep it, duplicate it, or even add multiple elements, even convert it, just like with the map. So you have a Swiss Army knife that can do a lot of things. So With that multimap, you can decide if that element is passed on, is if another value, if a converted value is passed, or even that you create new elements. For instance, suppose that you have a stream of numbers, and that based on the number, let's say that you receive number 5 in that multimap, that you create 5 new elements, for like 5 new random values, for instance. So based on that multimap, you can all do that and have a look at the examples to see how you can use that multimap and pass on new values. And the most obvious one is also in now, instead of using that collector with collectors.list, which is a very long way of just saying, I want to have a list, you can now just say to list. So we have a shorthand to describe it more easily. Be aware that there is a small difference. I'll show it you later that there is a difference between the two. Text blocks, and also a feature which is long discussed and was useful for a lot of people, so that you can define a string on multiple lines, so that you don't have to put the line breaks yourself. So you can define the string itself by using a triple quote. So you start with a triple quote, then you do a new line, and then you put your multiple line text, and you end again with that triple quote. The place where you put that last triple quote is important, because you can have, as you see there, a difference between incidental and intentional white spaces. The location of that last triple quote, the ending of your string, determines what spaces are important for you. So everything between the yellow line and the start of your text, like Olympic color, those two spaces in this example, they are kept within the string itself. Everything on the left side of the yellow line is not kept and is removed by the compiler. So you can decide what is kept as spaces within the string and what is removed, and it's just a way of noting it down in your source code. At the end of the line, all white space is also trimmed, unless you place somewhere a backslash s, and then all spaces between that your word, your last character, and that backslash s are kept within the string itself. Then the other one, which is a nice one, is that record class for those data transfer objects, where you just need to specify the two property names, x and y, for instance. You don't need to specify the constructor, no getters and setters. They are all auto-generated for you. The class is also final, so you cannot extend from that class. And there is one thing which is annoying for the Java enterprise developer, is that the properties do not follow the Java Bean specification for setters and getters. So for instance, if you have just a string x, then you have a method called x which returns the value of that property. But the JSONB specification, so suppose that you are using this DTO for returning a JSON string, then the JSONB specification defines that only getters should be considered. So methods which explicitly start with get or is. So that's why you need to use a little trick to get what you want. If you are using Jakarta E8, for instance, with JDK 17 and records, is that you need to define your property names like get name and get continent name in this example. Because then you have a method which is called getName, and you have a JSON property which is name, which is the intention of your code. So besides that little trick, even records can be used with JSONB and used in the application. you can define additional constructors there. You have the option to define it in case you need to perform some additional checks to see if a variable is valid, has the minimum length required, or those kind of things. There is the compact constructor, which does not have any parameters specified, but they have by default implied the same parameters and the same order as you define them on the record itself. So even if I specify their public country DTO, in fact, I'm specifying a constructor with two parameters, the first one a string and the second one also a string, the get name and the get continent name. What you always need to do with those constructors that you write yourself is that you need to assign both, or the number of properties that you have, a value, because for records, all the properties are expected to be final. So if you don't assign them in a constructor, you will get a compiler error, because that value is then, of course, not defined if you are using that constructor. And since it is final, it must have a constructor, it must have a value when the constructor finishes. This is called the canonical constructor, the constructor which has exactly the same parameters as the default one, which is auto-generated, but you can override then the functionality within the default generated for the records class. Again, don't forget to assign it. And of course, besides that compact one and the canonical one, you can create any kind of constructor with any kind of parameters, or without any parameters, with other types of parameters, etc. That's also possible, as long as you always assign those properties, as in this example, the this get name and the this get content name get a value assigned. Pattern matching for instance of. You probably have written a lot of time, if O instance of country, then assign that that cast that object O, that instance O, to a instance of that country. So now you can do what's called pattern matching. So you can assign the object O to a certain variable, in this example country, when the instance of is successful. So in this case, I test to see if that's a typical equals method. So if my object that I receive is not an instance of country, I return false and nothing happens. But if it's true, then also that country variable is assigned to the object O. So then after the if method, as you can see, I can use that variable and I can use to check it if the names are equals. That's add that instance of and there, and that assignment is also using that flow scoping that we know already, because if you define a variable within a method, that variable is accessible and you can use it after you have defined it. The same here, country is defined in that if statement, so after the if statement, I can use it. Because there the check is if false, then execute the if branch, then of course it is not accessible there, country, but if I say if O instance of country, then I can immediately use that, of course, country variable in that block. There is also called pattern matching for the switch expression now. I'm always wanting to say switch statement, but it's now, it is an expression where you can say, for instance, a switch of O in case of this string, then do something in case of an integer, do something else. And then if it's not one of those types, do something default by default. Again, if that matches, if the check is true, so the O is a string, then you can use that variable as after the successful matching. So in this case, you can use it in the case branch there. You see that I don't explicitly return here something, so that switch expression is returning void in this case. We have helpful null pointer exceptions. Again, people bring up that old joke that null pointer exception is the most common error in a language that doesn't have pointers. But anyway, we have now, when you have a.b.c.d equals 99, you have a null pointer exception. You now have at least an indication what is null. So if B is an OLL, so that means that I cannot dereferr it to get to C, then I get the indication in the error message that A.B returns null and that the statement failed for that reason. So at least now we don't have to debug our code to see which of those four or those three elements are an OLL to find out what went wrong. And then the last one that I'll quickly go over is the sealed classes, which controls how you can subclass. And so not only a final or the visibility parameters like protected or package scope define when you can see a class and can extend it. But now you have new keywords which say permits and non-sealed, which define if a certain class is able, can extend an interface or another class, etc. So have a look at the examples that you find online to see how you need to write it. I believe that's more for specific cases. It's not always useful, but I can assume that some people are eager to use those sealed classes. So time for see all those new language features in action. I have here a simple project. It's using Jakarta EE Web Profile 8. So it's not the most recent one, but it also works with JDK 17. I need to, of course, specify my target and source level of the compiler. And the only thing that I also need to do for Maven in this case is for the Maven WAR plugin, I need to use this or a later version due to that stricter encapsulation of those JDK internals. Earlier versions give an error saying that a certain package and class is not exposed to the unnamed module, which is solved here with this newer version. Then that's the only thing that you might need to change, for instance, for an existing application to compile it to JDK 17. And as I mentioned, you can still use all those older JDK 11 and older features, of course, because Java is still mainly backwards compatible. But in this example, I have a few specific language constructs used there. So say XRS endpoint. This example that was created because we have this year the Olympic Games. So it's, for instance, it returns a list of all countries with all continents. And this DTO isn't typically used in many XRS endpoints, where you return a specific set of data from your entity, from your database entity, for example. And as mentioned, I'm using then that record, but with a trick with the get name and the get continent name. How is that created? Well, I have a boundary here, which returns me the database ones. Actually, it's just using it in memory for the moment, until we have that Eclipse running on JDK 17, that Eclipse link. And then I stream them, I filter them on a certain continent, and I use here the canonical constructor by default of the record to convert my so-called entities to that DTO. And I'm using here the two list. As I mentioned, there is a difference, and it can be an important difference between the to list and the and using collectors to list, because to list is an unmodifiable list, whereas collectors to list is returning is just a regular array list. So that means that if you are planning to change the result of this method and you change the collectors to list to the shorthand, the to list itself, then of course you will have issues because you cannot modify, you cannot change that list which is returned here. So I'll make sure that I have JDK 17 here. I can do a Maven clean package. That works as before with that new version of that Maven WAR plugin, and I have here my WAR file specifically compiled with JDK 17. I have here also JDK 17 active, and I can do here the execution of Boyara Micro. I set the release candidate, which comes out next week. I define that there is no clustering required. Then I run that WAR file. Boyara Micro starts up on JDK 17. As mentioned, there is no problem, only with Eclipse Link we have there. You see again those endpoints. So if I curl, then the endpoint itself, like give me all countries in Europe, which returns that list of the TTO, returns a list of the records. I get the expected result, where I can see that I have an array, and with the elements of the JSON are there, then that record with those two elements, the continent name and the name of the country. So that is working as expected. Nice. Next thing is that are those text blocks. As I mentioned, triple quotes, my IDE helps me here with this, here it is a green line saying this this is intended white space, so that's, that value is kept, all the rest is discarded. I am using that var as a instead of a string, but it is actually a string because I can later on just use it in string format to replace that placeholder with the color. You know that each continent or each area in the world has a color in the Olympic meaning. So that's then done with that switch expression here, where I, based on that continent name, I return the value. If there are multiples, I can separate them by a comma. Otherwise, I can just return the one that that I need to return. So looking at an example where I ask, for instance, for the color for country 56, which is Belgium, then you see that I have that intentional white space here in front, but I have that string, which I defined here as a multi-line as a result. And the code is also using in the background that pattern matching here, where I assign that country, and that country variable is here used later on. So that's one thing. You have no issues running a Jakarta E8 application on JDK 17, compiled on JDK 17. The only thing that you need to watch out for is the name here of that record, the properties for those for that record here. But there are other changes which are maybe equally important because a application is just more than the code. You also need to run it on the runtime. And there are also important changes there. So to improve the experience for instance, for starting up with that class data sharing option, for those who are not aware about the details, you can look up on our YouTube channel, because I did a webinar around class data sharing in the past, describing how it works. But in one sentence, it is achieving a much faster startup of your application of Payara Micro, for instance, by preparing all the class information in a special archive file. And that archive file can then mapped within the memory space of your process, and it contains all the class information. It has all the verification done up front. So by doing that, you can achieve a startup improvement up to 35%. The OpenJDK version, OpenJDK 11 version, there you needed to use a three-step process, in essence. The first step was that you needed to create that classes list, that which contains a list of all the classes that need to be in that archive file. Second step was that the archive file must be created based on that classes list, and then you can use that archive file. Especially that second step, that takes some time, which is, of course, is not nice. And OpenJ9, also in JDK 11 version already, used another technique, which is, of course, much much easier and faster, is that at the moment that your JVM exits, that that archive file is created at that moment, because everything is already in memory. The JVM knows which classes are in use, and it is already verified. It is already in the correct format, so it dumps your classes memory space to an archive file, and you can immediately use it. So that's now also used for OpenJDK version 17, where you can specify those archive classes at exit parameter, and then you can immediately use that, which is, of course, easier and faster. And it gives you faster class data sharing. With class data sharing, you get faster startup without the need to rewrite your application. That's, of course, also a good thing. Let us see what we can achieve. So let's first start our application without anything. So that's the reference value that I want to define. So I start Payara Micro. And again, it is that it's that RC1 version. There is a small application in this deployment directory, and I started up without any clustering requirements. So this is a normal startup on JDK 17, which is already faster than on 11 and 8. I will show you some figures in a moment. But you can see Payara Micro is ready to serve requests in 5.4 seconds. So keep that value in mind, because we will compare it with the result if we apply CDS. So we define first that archive classes at exit. So it creates that payara.jsa file. And with the option that we have with Payara Micro here with that warm-up, that means that when the system is ready, when Payara Micro is ready, then it shuts it down itself. So that warm-up parameter was specifically designed for these kind of things like CDS, because everything is ready, and then he generates that that archive file. You can see here, and then he generates this one. It's around the same size as the jar itself. There are a few classes missing, that's why it is smaller. Once we have that archive file, and see also that it is read-only, so that's the intention, so that you cannot tamper with it, because otherwise you can have again some issues with security. So then when we use it, we can just specify that archive class file. Archive file is not a class file. And we specify here that not the Payara Micro, but the Launch Micro. I skipped that step because the classic Payara Micro expands itself and then adds jar files dynamically to the class loader, which is not which the CDS option doesn't like. So that's why we created a output launcher, but more on that in my presentation. But if we started up now with that archive file, it is not much different because probably I'm screen sharing, but you can have up to 20% of the difference here. It's only now 0.2 seconds. But if I do it in a more controlled way, then you can have a systematic difference of around 20% startup. That it is better, that the startup time is improved. Main thing is here that now with JDK 17, it is easier to create that that archive file, that it's no longer a long process with different steps that you need to follow. But not only the JDK 17 starts up faster if you compare it to JDK 11, for instance, and JDK 8, but there are also improvements in the garbage collectors themselves. There are those two new garbage collectors, but even at the G1 collector, there is a real improvement made. So again, what did I do? I used that same Payara Micro binary that I can run on JDK 11 and JDK 17, so that's identical. I assigned it in both cases only 256 megabyte of heap, which is not that much because my app, the same app again, running on those on that Payara Micro, so compiled for JDK 11 in this case, there is a method which requires a lot of CPU and memory. It's creating prime values, but in a very inefficient way, so that it's using a lot of threads, CPU, and memory. And if I put then some statistics there on the right, you see then the graph that that the response time for creating that those prime values is dramatically lower on JDK 17 than 11. So again, around 20% faster response time. Probably not always. If you have simple request, that's probably not that big issue. If it's a few milliseconds faster, but in sometimes, especially when you have systems with under high stress with CPU and memory, that it responds better for the end user, then of course that's a good thing. Flight recorder, for those who knows it, you can do profiling and diagnostics with it because it constantly captures all kinds of events that you can analyze in the flight recorder tool. But now you can also use flight recorder for monitoring, and you have, for instance, that flight recorder event streaming. The classic thing is that that the events are collected, stored in a buffer, in a temporary repository, and then you can write it to file in case you have an issue for diagnostic. For instance, your JVM crashes or there is a slow performance, then with that flight recorder event file, you can diagnose the internals of the JVM. But now you can, with that event stream, you can even listen to that buffer, that internal buffer. So you can, for instance, create a Java agent. I can show it you on this page how it works. So the events are collected in that memory buffer. You can have a listener there so that a Java agent, for instance, a JDK agent, which you have started together with your application, can connect to it and can receive the events that you are interested in. Only the memory ones or your custom ones, you can define which kind of events you receive, and you can perform whatever is required. You can stream it elsewhere, you can analyze it there and make some decisions, etc. you can also listen to the facts, to the moment that those events are written to that temporary repository, so that you can write a secondary Java process, for instance, that watches that repository and also receives that those events. I have also an example with that. It's a bit more complicated, but hopefully everything works well. So first of all, I have my application, which I'm starting. So starting up application again with not much memory. And it's the same application that I used to test there the garbage collectors. So I have here a method that takes a lot of memory and CPU. So that's one thing here. Then I need to configure it to have that temporary repo file in a certain location so that I can listen to it. So let's first find the process number. Then I need to configure that flight recorder. So you can do that, all those things you can do externally, as you can see. So configure it to a certain path. So 9.2.4.2.5. So with that JCMD, you can have a look at your Java process in many ways. You can look at system properties. You can even change them. You can start the flight recorder itself, what I'm going to do now. With the JFR start, I can start flight recorder process. Let's make sure that I use the correct process ID. So it is started. It has the correct location. And then I can here start another program, which opens that repository, which I have configured there. And he listens to certain events. In this example, I listen to the garbage collection events and I start listening to it. So my process is starting, so I can run this one. And for the moment, there are no events going on because I don't see anything. But if I launch that intensive endpoint, so it's again with the curl one, this one, then you see that here all events from the JDK of that other process. So it is entirely out of process connection. I see when the event started, how long that it took, etc., etc. And so all that information is available. I can watch out for any kind of event as long as it is created within with that flight recorder system. So one of the things that you can do there is build your own monitoring tool, monitoring system, which is built within the application so that your application can react on it and so that you have a feedback loop of how your application is doing within your application. So that's one of the nice things that you can do with it. And I see that we have a few minutes time, so I can quickly go over a few security related changes. You need to be, if you are using explicitly TLS 1.0 or the 1.1 version, most of the time you just say, I want to have a secure connection, then it chooses the version which is available. But if you explicitly on a connection, for instance, on a socket, request a older version, TLS 1.0, for example, those are now disabled. That was also already the case in JDK 11. Version 0.11, but in JDK 17, they are also disabled. So your program will not work then, of course. And also some weak curves for the elliptic curves algorithms are also disabled. So they should not be used anymore. So that can be an issue if you explicitly make references to them. But there are new algorithms. I always find it a funny name, the Cha-Cha 20. And you have also that Poly 1305 algorithms. You have new algorithms for the hash MAC calculation there. You can also now have TLS support with those Edward curves, which is also something new. And a few nice things, personally, I find a few nice things is that you can, that you have some system properties to configure the entire TLS subsystem now. And the availability of context-specific deserialization filters. You know that deserialization from anything to Java can be problematic because you take in some foreign content and there are a few security holes so that some classes, some static methods can be invoked, which can be dangerous. And now you can define some filters so that you say that some classes are allowed and other are rejected, even if they are in the serialized format, which makes, of course, a great improvement on security because you can make, you can exclude those problematic classes, for example, if you are not using them, of course, otherwise you still have an issue. So that's it. Are there any questions? I see there is a question. What is the anticipated release time frame for full Payara with JDK 17 support? Well, our plan is to release it in November. So mid-November, you will have Payara Server and Payara Micro fully functional on JDK 17. That is the plan. It might be the case that it is a month later, but we are planning for mid of November. So in 1 month's time, more or less.
All right. I don't see any other questions. So I'll just kind of go through some things here, and then if anyone has any other questions, feel free to pop them in the tab or in the chat. So I would just like to thank you again for an excellent presentation today, and just a reminder, if anyone does have any questions, just to ask now. Our next Jakarta Tech Talk happens October 19th with Tyler Van Gorder as he presents automated refactoring for Java-based applications, and you can register for that with the link in the chat. I'll send that. Perfect. And then we're also looking to book more Jakarta Tech Talks throughout the fall in 2021. So if you're interested, I will put the link for that as well in the chat. Let me just see if there's any other questions. I don't see any other questions, but we also do have our Jakarta One live stream. So the biggest Jakarta event of the year on December 7th. So I encourage you to also register for that, as there will be a lot of great talks and content that will come from there. That I'll put in here. There you go. And I don't see any other questions. So Rudy, I'd just like to thank you guys again, and thanks to the audience. I hope everyone has a great day.
Yep. Thank you. And
thank you.
And you can switch over in a few minutes to the Jakarta EE update call. So then you are also updated about Jakarta EE 10.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Have a good day.
Bye, everyone.